We bless you, Father. Let your name be praised in our midst tonight. You are the one who changes the hearts of men. It is by you understanding comes to us. Holy Spirit, you are the Spirit of truth. We ask you to fill this place and fill this whole atmosphere with your truth. Let every heart here be filled with truth by the time we are leaving tonight. Thank you, Holy Spirit. We submit our minds to you that you will teach us your word and transform our lives. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may be seated. This evening we're going to be talking about tithing. And it's a command that the Lord has commanded me to teach this. And until the body of Christ begins to, not just begin, they fully come to understand God's intention concerning tithes, we can't stop. As we begin to go into this teaching, you will see, your eyes will be opened. Hallelujah. Now let's start with the popular scripture that you all know concerning tithing. Let's just open it. I won't tell you the scripture. When we open it, you know if you know it or not. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. Are you there? Are you in the most popular tithing scripture? Do you know it? Are you sure? Okay, put it up if you know it. Why are you hiding the scripture? Is that where you opened? Who opened somewhere different? Praise God. Now let's read this. One to go. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. Praise God. Now you've quoted this scripture severally. You've listened to this scripture being preached severally. Anytime you think of tithe, oh, bring ye all the tithe. No, let's not go into William and rob God and all that. You already know that. Praise God. But now he says, bring ye all the tithe into the storehouse, that there may be meat, there may be food in my house. And try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts. Hallelujah. This question must have come into your heart, if not severally. Because many people have asked me that question. God says, when we tithe, he will open the windows of heaven and pour us out a blessing. Isn't that what God said? Isn't that what God said? Now, are we truly enjoying what God said? You've been tithing. Is there anyone that have not been tithing here? You've not been paying your tithe. If you haven't, well, let's finish the message today. But the truth about this scripture is that God actually wasn't talking to you. You know, yesterday we said something. We said, when you study scriptures, don't just read the scripture and pick anything there. You must first of all understand who was God talking to, and then next you must understand on what basis was he saying what he was saying. So I'll know if this scripture is for me or it's for someone else. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now, first of all, this is a scripture that you quote and then you take your tithes to church. Am I right? And I've had this argument with several people. And most times people insist that, okay, you take your tithe to church. Well, first of all, this scripture was not given, or God speaking here, he wasn't speaking to everybody. God was actually speaking to the priests and the Levites in this scripture. Hallelujah. When you study scriptures, and we're going to look at that, you will discover that there is no place in the Bible that God commanded his children to bring the tithe to the church or to the temple. Nowhere in scripture. I know you're surprised. Good. I got the attention. Praise God. I said there is none. You can go and study for yourself. Don't just take what I say today. After you leave today, say, let it be a challenge. Try to disprove what I say. But I trust that the Holy Spirit will open your eyes to more. Hallelujah. I want us to go to several scriptures where God talked about tithing. So you'll begin to see Leviticus. Book of Leviticus. The last chapter, chapter 27. You see, the first time tithe is revealed to us as regards human relationship with God was when Abraham met Melchizedek. Praise God. That was the first time tithe was revealed. Now, after Moses came and Moses gave them the law, and God began to instruct even concerning tithing. Verse 30. And all the tithe of the land, whether of the seed of the land or of the fruit of the tree, is the Lord's. It is holy unto the Lord. Praise God. God is instructing you that all the tithe belongs to who? Belongs to who? Talk to me. Belongs to who? It belongs to the Lord. He says it is holy unto the Lord. That means it is God's portion. It's not for you. It is God's own. Now that's why in Malachi he can say, you're robbing me because you're not bringing the tithe. Do you understand? It's not something you willingly say, out of my free will, I'm giving my tithe. No, it belongs to God. That's what God said. Numbers 18. Numbers 18 and verse 24. Now, look at this scripture. For the tithe of the children of Israel, which they offer up as a heave offering to the Lord. Now, I want you to get something. He says, for the tithe of the children of Israel, which they offer up as a heave offering to the Lord. Now, why did he say the tithe which they offer as heave offering? That's letting you know that tithe is also an offering. Now, there are several offerings that God commanded them to give. When you study Leviticus, you will see all those offerings. Then, now what is the heave offering? The heave offering is when your crops, now, you know, then they were dealing on crops and animals. Now, when it's harvest time, the first set of harvest that you have, you know, like yam, they say new yam. You understand what I'm talking about? Now, when that new yam comes out, that first set of yam, as you harvest it, now, the tithe of it is a special kind of tithe that is called the heave offering tithe. Do you understand me? Do you understand me? I need you to follow. Now, that first set of harvest that you get, when you remove the tithe, God calls that particular tithe the heave offering tithe. So when you're offering that tithe, it's different from every other tithe. Now he says, for the tithe of the children of Israel, which they offer up as heave offering to the Lord, I have given to the Levite as an inheritance. Did you get that? He says, I have given it. So that first harvest, when you remove your tithe from it, God says, I have given it to who? Talk to me. Who? The Levites, as an inheritance. Therefore, I have said to them, among the children of Israel, they shall have no inheritance. Next verse. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, go ahead. Speak to us to the Levites and say to them, when you take from the children of Israel the tithe which I have given you, from them as your inheritance, then you shall offer up a heave offering of it to the Lord as a tithe of the tithe. Did you get that? The Levites, when they take the tithe, now which tithe are they taking? The heave offering tithe. when they take it from the children of Israel, they are to pay the tithe of it. Did you get that? Good. Next verse. And your heave offering shall be reckoned to you as though it were the grain of the threshing floor and as the fullness of the winepress. God is saying, you know, he told the Levites, don't work. Don't do anything. Just attend to the service of the temple. Now, when the children of Israel bring their heave offering, that belongs to you, the Levites. Now, when you receive it, you must tithe from it. Praise God. You must tithe from it. Now, when you tithe from it, I reckon it as though you did your business. And this is the harvest that you got. So, everybody is equal. Now, notice, this heave offering tithe, God specifically said, I have given it to who? To who? The Levites. Deuteronomy chapter 14. Deuteronomy 14 and verse 22. Now look at what God is speaking. He's saying here. He says, you shall truly tithe of the increase of your grain that the field produces year by year. Next verse. Now look at this. Look at this. Look at this very carefully. I want us to read that first part together. One, two, go. You shall what? You shall what? You shall what? You shall what? Eat before the Lord. What? Go on. In the place, go on reading. In the place where he chooses to make his name abide. What? Hold on. God is saying you shall eat the tithe. Did you read that? Did you read that? Did you read that? Now, notice the first one we read, he says, is the heave offering tithe. The heave offering tithe. It belongs to who? It belongs to who? The Levites. Now, here he says, you shall eat in a place where the Lord chooses to make his name known, the tithe of your grain and new wine and your oil and the firstborn of your heads and your flock. Now, that's another set of tithes. Are you following me? That's another set of tithes. Now, God says, this tithe does not belong to the Levites. This tithe belongs to who? Belongs to who? Now, he has already said all the tithe belong to the Lord. Now, in giving instruction concerning the tithe, the first one, he says, belongs to the Levites, the heave offering tithe. Now, this one, he specifically said, the tithe of the grain and new wine and oil and of the firstborn of your heads, it belongs to you. But guess what? The fact that it belongs to you doesn't mean you just go and carry it and do whatever you like. God specifically told them how to treat it. Watch. And you shall eat before the Lord, your God, in the place where he chooses to make his name abide. The place where God chooses to make his name to abide. That's like the temple. You understand what I'm saying? Where he chooses that this is where my presence will be. Now he says, you will go and eat the tithe in that place. He didn't say you go and drop the tithe in that place. He said you will go and you will take the tithe, go there, sit down, cook in that place and eat it. Now, next verse. It says, but if the journey is too far for you, so that you are not able to carry the tithe. Are you following now? Good. If the place where the Lord your God chooses to put his name is too far from you, when the Lord your God has blessed you. Next verse. Then you shall exchange it for money. Take the money in your hand and go to the place which the Lord your God chooses. Next verse. And you shall spend that money on whatever your heart desires. For oxen, for sheep, for wine, for similar drinks, for whatever your heart desire, you shall eat there before the Lord your God, and you shall rejoice, you and who? You and who? Your household. Now, you've never heard this practiced. Am I right? Who has practiced this before? You've never heard this practice. You've never heard this talked about. Now, This is one place that God says, bring it, take it to the temple, but you're not going to offer it in the temple. You and your family, when God has blessed you, you take that tithe and gather your family and say, we are going to the house of the Lord. To do what? To eat our tithe. Hallelujah. Verse 28. Now look at this. At the end of every third year, you shall bring out the tithe of your produce of that year and store it up within your what? Gates. Now, this is another kind of tithe. This is the tithe of the third year. Meaning, this tithe is paid every three years. Now, every three years, according to God's command, every three years, you are to gather all the tithe for that year. This tithe of the third year, you don't pay it when you get it. You don't pay it when you are blessed. No, you gather it up until the end of the year. If it's now, December. Are you following me? Now it says, and at the end of every third year, you shall bring out. At the end of the third year, you bring it out. The tithe of your produce of that year. And store it up within your gates. Next verse. And the Levites. Watch this. And the Levites, because he has no portion or inheritance with you. And the stranger, and the fatherless, and the widow who are within your gates may come and eat and be satisfied, that the Lord your God may bless you in all the work of your hands which you do. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, when you study the whole scriptures, these are the three kinds of tithes that God talked about. The first one, the heave tithe, belongs to who? Belongs to who? Belongs to who? The Levites. So you give it to the Levites. Now the Levites, they are not the priests. The priest is different from the Levites. Now in all this mention of tithes that we read, you never saw one place that God mentioned the priest. Did you see any? I said you can go study for yourself. That's not where we're dwelling. Hallelujah. But never did God say they should bring their tithes to the priest. The closest is the Levites. And then, the third year, God says, you bring the tithes and keep at your gates. You just keep it there. Then, anybody that wants, the Levites, he comes and takes what he wants. The stranger, who's the stranger? The foreigner. He comes and takes what he wants. Who else? The fatherless, they come and they take what they want. The widows, they come and they take what they want. They take to their full as much as they want. Now, you remember Jesus one time when he wanted to go into Jerusalem. He sent his disciples. He said, go into the city. You will get to this particular street. When you get there, you will see two asses tied, which no man has ever rode on. You remember that story? He says, loosen it and bring it for me. Now, if anybody asks you, why are you loosening it? Tell them. What did he say you should tell them? What did he say you should tell them? The Lord has need of it. Now, that was not a special miracle that Jesus did. You know, just go and carry somebody's animal. And if they ask you, who are you taking this? The Lord has no. Okay, well, since it's the Lord, I have no. No, sir. That was the tithe that somebody kept there. Are you following? That was somebody's tithe, according to this command that God gave to them. That's why no man has ever rode on it. Because he had kept it. Do you understand? They had kept it. They knew it was the tithe right from the day it was born. So they kept it. And that year, it's time to bring the tithe of this out. So they brought it and they tied it. Maybe there were other things there, we don't know. But the one Jesus told them to bring is the animal. And actually they went and they loosened it. And people came and said, why are you loosening that? I said, the Lord has need of it. Oh, okay. You see, Jesus didn't say, tell them Jesus have need of it. If they had said, Jesus have need of it, say, who are you? Get out of this place. He said, the Lord. So that's your response. He said, tell them the Lord. Now, when you say the Lord, they'll say, oh, this must be from the Levites. It's okay, you can take it. Hallelujah. Now, Nehemiah chapter 10, verse 37. Now, these people were, you remember, you know the story of Nehemiah. He went to rebuild the temple and the city. Now, after building, they began to make confessions before the Lord. And they got to this place that they said several things, but this is where it's important. Now, watch. It says, to bring the, okay. It says, to bring the first fruit of our dough, our offerings, the first, the fruit from all kinds of tree, the new wine and oil. To who? The priests. To the storehouses of the house of our God. Now look at this part. Look at this next part. And to bring the tithe of our land to who? To who? Now you need to follow this. Now they say the first fruit and all that is they bring to who? The priests. But the tithe of our land. Now watch. The tithe of our land. To bring to the tithe of our land to the Levites. For the Levites should receive the tithe in all our farming communities. 38. Next verse. Now watch. Watch this. And the priests, the descendants of Aaron, shall be with the Levites when the Levites receive the tithe. And the Levites shall bring up a tenth of the tithe. To where? To where? To where? The house of our God. To the where? Rooms of the storehouse. Who brings the tithe to the rooms of the storehouse? Who brings it? Who brings it? The Levites. Now, where are the Levites to collect the tithe? No, let's read it. 37. 37. Go back to 37. Look at that last part. For the Levites should receive the tithe in all our farming communities. So the Levites were like tax collectors. When it's harvest time, the Levites go round. Yes, I have come. Family A, your heave offering tithe. And say, oh, sir. They gather it and they bring it. And that's where they stop. Now he says, the priests. Next verse, 38. And the priests, the descendants of Aaron, shall be with the Levites when the Levites receive the tithe, possibly for accountability. Praise God. They shall be with the Levites when the Levites receive the tithe. And the Levites shall bring up a tenth. You remember when God gave them this command? The Levites shall bring up a tenth of the tithe to the house of our God, to the rooms of the storehouse. So when God said in Malachi, bring all the tithe into the storehouse, he wasn't talking to you. He was talking to the Levites. You see, Malachi, the book of Malachi actually was written because of the priests and the Levites. If you study it carefully. Now, Prophet Malachi was actually rebuking the Levites and the priests. Why? Because everything is just going wrong. And because of them also, they were not bringing tithe to the storehouse. It was the Levites that were not bringing the tithe to the storehouse. Not the people. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, understanding this, and remember, everything we just read now is under the law that God gave to them. Praise God. But reading through these things, remember the scripture says these things were written for our what? Learning. They were written for our learning. So that we, through comfort of the scriptures, might have hope. What does that mean? Because these things have been written for me to learn from. Meanwhile, we should have enough sense over here in the New Testament to know that when you read these kind of things, you should be careful with them. Why? Because the letter kill it. Do you understand what I'm saying? So we should be careful. We should know that we are to learn from this. But when it comes to practicing in the New Testament, we know one thing. We should be led by the Spirit. Are you following me? In the New Testament, we are led by the Spirit of God. In the Old Testament, they were led by these laws. But why did God keep all this record for us? So that we will learn from these things. And so that when the Spirit of God begins to lead us, and we're a bit confused, we can look into this thing and say, oh, God actually led them through this path also. So the voice I'm hearing is not really wrong. For example, you package your tithe. You see, you are all used to that tradition. You take your tithe to church. That's the tradition you are used to. It's been passed down from ages. Now, you take your tithe. Someone asked the question in the morning that they were somewhere and they were a bit stranded. And the only person that had money there in their midst was said it was only his tithe he had with him. And he refused to release the money. And they were in their need of money. And he asked me if that was right or wrong. And of course, those of you that were here in the morning, my response was, we can't judge. Because the guy is not here. Until the guy is here and tells us what was in his mind when he did that, that's what we can say if he's right or wrong. Because you don't know if the Holy Spirit said, thou shalt not release this money. Praise God. Praise God. But guess what? You're preparing, oh, God has blessed you, and here's the tithe. You're preparing to take it to church on Sunday. And then you hear a voice, go and give it to that widow over there. Ah, no, this is my tithe. No. Ah, hey, no, hey, no. That, how can I give my tithe to a widow? No, it's for church. Now, you can be confused like that until you come across scriptures like this. And you say, oh, wait, God actually told them there's a part, there's a tithe that they give to widows. There's a tithe they give to fatherless people. There's a tithe you give to strangers. Really? Oh, so that voice I heard was not strange after all. Are you following me? So that voice I heard was not strange. Now, that's the same reason I have read all the scriptures to you for your learning. Now, let's go into the truth concerning tithe. Having established, you see, I shared this with you to unsettle your mind. Get it out, shake it off from that religious thing that has held it down. Now, let's go into the truth concerning tithe. Genesis chapter 14. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Verse 18. Then, maybe let's start from verse 17. And the king of Sodom went out to meet him. You know, the background story was when Abraham went to deliver Lot. After Lot was captured. And he went with his servants, fought those kings, delivered Lot and all the people of Sodom that were captured. And then he brought them back. And the king of Sodom went out to meet him at the valley of Shaveh. That is the king's valley. After his return from the defeat of Chedorlaomer. Praise God. And the kings who were with him. Next verse. Then Melchizedek, king of Salem. Now, notice he called him what? He called him what? He called him what? King of Salem. What is Salem? What is Salem? What is Salem? Peace. So he called him what? King of peace. Praise God. King of Salem brought out, notice, what this king was carrying. What was he carrying? Bread and wine. And notice the next thing he said about this man. This king carrying bread and wine was also the priest of the Most High. He was a king and he was also a priest. Who is this man? Why did he meet Abraham? Where did he come from to meet Abraham? Why was he carrying bread and wine? Why is he called priest of the Most High? Next verse. And he blessed him and said, blessed be Abraham of the Most High God, of the Most High, possessor of heaven and earth. Next verse. And blessed be the Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hand. And he gave him tithe, a tithe of all. Now, remember the writer was not there when this thing was happening. It was narrated to him. And when things are narrated, most times you don't get the details. But I want you to think a bit. This man was carrying bread and wine. And then the Bible tells us that he blessed Abraham. Do you think for any reason he must have given Abraham the wine and the bread? Do you think it's possible he must have given it to him? I believe 100% that that was the purpose for which he brought it. Now, he gave Abraham the bread and the wine and spoke words over Abraham. And the words he spoke were too powerful. The kind of words he spoke, you know that it's not a normal man that was speaking those words. And what was Abraham's response to this whole thing that happened? Abraham gave him the tithe of everything that he had. What kind of transaction was that? What took place in this scripture? Why is it recorded? You know, there are things you read in the Bible, you just wish the whole story was unveiled for us to see. Why? The way it even introduced him. It said the king of Abraham was coming from a journey, and then the king of Sodom was going to meet him, and then Melchizedek came as though, you know, imagine the king of Sodom was coming, and suddenly Melchizedek just entered his front and said, Abraham. That's how the story goes. Luke. But why did he meet Abraham then? Why was he carrying bread and wine? Now, this was before the law was given through Moses. Now, that's to tell you that there must be something about the tithe. Now, Abraham was the first man in the Bible that we clearly can read his life and relationship with God. You understand what I'm saying? Abraham is the first man that you can say, okay, I want to see somebody who walked with God and was blessed. We look at Abraham. Of course, Noah came before Abraham, but Noah built the ark. But you don't see Noah and God conversing. You don't see high and low points. Do you understand what I'm saying? So, you get what I'm saying? So, Abraham is the first man that we see a real relationship, man dealing with the Lord. And he tells us this. Now, when you read this, you ask yourself the question, is it possible that this had happened before? Maybe to someone else. Is it just possible? Is it possible Abraham knew that when you meet Melchizedek, this is how to respond to him? Is it just possible? But we don't know, except the Spirit of God reveals to us. Hallelujah. But this is recorded for us to learn and to know that this happened. And it tells us he was a king. He was a priest of the Most High. Now, the law came, and everything I've read to you came into play. And Jesus shows up and put the law aside. And now, in our day, in our time, we are no more under the law. Do you understand that? We are no more under the law. Now, we are under a new dispensation. And this new dispensation, what controls us is the Spirit of God that controls us. But something very amazing. Jesus walked on this earth, and then one day he gathered his disciples together and he brought something that we'll never read anywhere else apart from here. Wine and bread. And he stood before them. He says, take, eat. This is my body that is broken for you. Take, drink. This is my blood that is shed for you. He said, do it, and do it as often as you have to do it. Apart from when Melchizedek brought it to Abraham, we never read anywhere else that the Bible talked about bread and wine until Jesus Christ. Now, Jesus is called the Prince of Peace. The Prince of Peace. Who's Melchizedek called? Who's Melchizedek called? The King of Peace. Now, Matthew chapter 1 and verse 18. The prince is the child of a king. Am I right? Matthew 1, 18. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. After his mother, Mary, was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of who? She was found with child of who? Who's Jesus' daddy? Who's Jesus' daddy? So is he qualified to be the prince? Melchizedek then was who? Who then was Melchizedek? Talk to me. No. If Jesus is the Prince of Peace, and this scripture tells us that Jesus, Mary was found with child of the Holy Ghost, meaning the Holy Ghost is Jesus' father. So who was Melchizedek? Melchizedek, therefore, was the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, Melchizedek showed up with Abraham, finished his ministry, and you never hear of him. Then, someone shows up on earth, and he says, I am the Prince of Peace. Who's the King of Peace? Melchizedek. You're his son? Yes. You know, because of that, the Jews hated him. And they stoned him. They almost stoned him, sorry. They took up stones to stone him. Because of this truth. But we find Jesus now bringing that same thing that Melchizedek brought to Abraham. Like I said in the morning, I don't know how the disciples responded. Maybe they've not read about Abraham. When Jesus said, take, this is my body, take, this is my blood. If I was there and I had this understanding, I would say, Jesus, wait first, wait till I'm coming. I'll run, go and bring my tithes. And I'll say, Master, here's my tithes. So the blessing will be complete. But what's the relationship with the tithe, with the bread and the wine, and this King of Peace and the High Priest of God? Why all that drama? Hebrews chapter 7. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hebrews chapter 7 from verse 1. This is going to be a long read, so get ready. Hebrews 7. Now, watch. You know, in Hebrews chapter 5, the writer mentioned Melchizedek. And then he now said, this one is too high. Let me not go into it right now. And then he went into chapter 6 talking about several other things and then came back to Melchizedek. That's why it starts with, for this Melchizedek, means he had mentioned him before. Praise God. For this Melchizedek, King of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him. Next verse. For to whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all, being for first being translated King of Righteousness, and then also King of Salem, meaning King of Peace. Next verse. Without father, without mother, without genealogy, having neither beginning of days nor end of days. This just summarizes the truth that we've all already know. This is the Holy Ghost. Praise God. But made like the Son of God, remains a priest continually. Remember, he was the priest when he first showed up. He was the priest of the Most High God. Now here he tells us that he remains a priest continually. Fine, next verse. Now consider how great this man was, to whom even the patriarch Abraham gave a tenth of the spoil. Next verse. And indeed, those who are of the sons of Levi, who receive the priesthood, have a commandment to receive tithes from the people according to the law. Did you see that? Did you see that? According to what? According to what? The law. So it was the law that empowered the Levites to collect tithes from the people. You know, it was the law that established the Levitical priesthood. You understand what I'm saying? Now, it was that law that empowered them to collect tithe from the people. So now it says, according to the law, that is from their brethren, though they have come from the loins of Abraham. Next verse. But he whose genealogy is not derived from them received tithe from Abraham. Now, see that word, receive tithe. Now, if you go to Genesis, you will say Abraham gave him a tithe. Do you understand? Possibly, Abraham met Melchizedek more than one time. Possibly. And blessed him who had the promise. Next verse. Now, beyond all contradiction, the lesser is blessed by the better. Next verse. Here, mortal men receive tithes. Now, who is he referring to? According to law, the Levites. They were mortal men. So he says, here, mortal men receive tithes, but there he receives them of whom it is witness that he lives. Next verse. Even Levi, who received tithe, paid tithe through Abraham, so to speak. Next verse. For he was still in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him. Next verse. Therefore, if perfection were through the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, what further need was there that another priest should rise according to the order of Melchizedek and not be called according to the order of Aaron? The Levitical priesthood, they were made priests after the order of what? Aaron. But even before Aaron, there was a priesthood, Melchizedek. Now, when God brought the law, he actually put aside the priesthood of Melchizedek and brought about a new law and a new priesthood to administer that law, because this had to do with men and what men could relate with. But he said, therefore, if perfection were through the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, what further need was there that another priest should rise according to the order of Melchizedek and not be called according to the order of Aaron? What's God doing? What he's asking, if perfection was gotten through that Levitical priesthood, all that laws that gave to them, he said, why then would God now come and set up another priest after the order of Melchizedek and not after the order of Aaron? He's asking, meaning something must have been wrong. Meaning perfection was not gotten under that priesthood. Next verse. For the priesthood being changed, of necessity there is also a change of the law. Next verse. For he of whom these things are spoken belong to another tribe, from which no man has officiated at the altar. Next verse. For it is evident that our Lord arose from Judah, of which tribe Moses spake nothing concerning priesthood. Next verse. And it is yet far more evident if in the likeness of Melchizedek there ariseth another priest. Next verse. Who has come not according to the law of a fleshly commandment, but according to the power of an endless life. Next verse. For he testifies, you are a priest forever. You are a priest forever, according to the order of who? This is speaking of who? Jesus. He says, you are a priest forever, according to the priesthood, according to the order of Melchizedek. Next verse. For on the one hand, there is an annulling of the former commandment because of its weaknesses and unprofitableness. Next verse. For the law made nothing perfect. On the other hand, there is the bringing in of a better hope through which we draw near to God. Why did God put away that other priesthood? Because it was blocking them from getting to God. Now he says, on the one hand, God found that priesthood faulty, because it was not profitable to them. And then on the other hand, God wanted to establish this new priesthood so that it would draw men to him. Are you following? Now let's read the next verse. See what it says. And inasmuch as he was not made priest without an oath. Go on. For they have become priests without an oath, but he with an oath by him who said to him, the Lord has sworn and will not relent. You are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. What's he saying? The Aaronic priesthood, God commissioned them. He just commissioned them. Go and be priests. But concerning this one, he made an oath, meaning it can never be changed. This is the original plan. It's not a new plan. Do you understand? It's not a new plan. It was the original plan that God suspended. I said, well, let me try something else and see if it will work. And he tried it, but it didn't work. And he said, I'm going back to the original. So Jesus, you are a priest, not after Aaron, after the order of Melchizedek. Why? Because I want to draw men to me. Now then, one of the major things that this priesthood does, which we find in his father, Melchizedek, was to receive the tithe from Abraham. It then also means that in this order, Jesus receives the tithe from us today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, how does Jesus receive the tithe from us? Now, first of all, you ask the question, must we tithe? You see, Abraham, like I said, I wish they told us more about why did he give his tithes to Melchizedek. I wish they told us that one. But you see, when you study scriptures, one of the things Bible scholars will tell you, there's this thing they call the law of first mention. When something was mentioned first in the Bible, go and check it very well. Now, every other thing that will talk about it has to take a cue from it. Praise God. Now, you find this first man who had a relationship with God, established that he had a relationship with God. You find him bringing his tithe. And then you find that God blessed him. Now, God promised him and said, Abraham, I will bless you and I will bless your seed. In the morning, I said to them, when you confess Abraham's blessings are mine, you must understand what you're saying. Abraham's blessings are mine. It's not saying, okay, Abraham was blessed with houses and land, so I receive houses and land. They are Abraham's blessings, so they are mine. No, that's not what God said to Abraham. God said to Abraham, I will bless you, and I will bless your seed. He didn't say, I will bless you, and you will not transfer the blessing to your seed. No, he says, I will bless you, and I will bless your seed. So the contract, the blessing that God gave Abraham was that his seed qualifies for a blessing with God. Do you understand that? Do you understand that? Now, the Bible tells us in Galatians that if ye be Christ, then you are what? Abraham's seed, an heir. Now, look at that word. It says you are an heir according to the promise. He didn't say you are heir to the promise. He said you are heir according to the promise. What's he saying? It means you qualify to receive a blessing directly from God because you are Abraham's seed. Now, it doesn't have to be the way God blessed Abraham that he will bless his seed. I don't know if you understand that. But one thing is certain. Because God blessed Abraham, when his seed comes, according to that promise that God made to Abraham, God said, I will bless your seed also. Now I'm here, and I'm in Christ, and I discover I am the seed of Abraham. What do? Father, I have come to receive my blessing. Do you understand? I have come to receive my blessing. For in the promise you made to Abraham, you said you will bless his seed. Okay, I am the seed of Abraham. I have come. Now, every one of us that belongs to Christ, you have a right to go before God to receive a blessing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But you find Abraham coming to receive the blessing, and you find him with tithe. If Abraham's seed ought to receive the blessing, then they have to do the same thing that Abraham did. Come with the tithe. Come to where? Come to Jesus with the tithe. Oh, how do I get to Jesus? Jesus, before he left, specifically said, I'm not leaving you comfortless. I'm sending the Holy Spirit to you. And he left us with the Holy Spirit. And today, because the Holy Spirit is with us, we know that Jesus is with us. What then does that mean? When I want to pay my tithe, when I have been blessed and I take out my tithe, what am I supposed to do? I'm supposed to go to the Holy Spirit. He is now the high priest. Hallelujah. He is now the high priest. And I go before him and say, Lord, you have blessed me. Here is the tithe of the blessing that you have blessed me with. So now, Lord, having brought my tithe, what do you want me to do with it? Hallelujah. Then it is now his own prerogative to say, give it to your church, or give it to that person over there, or give it to that widow over there, or send it to that preacher over there, or send whatever he chooses to tell you. Now, the Old Testament gives us an idea that it was not just stereotype. Do you understand? It gives us that idea. So it means the Holy Spirit can begin to distribute the tithe as he wants. Yours is to obey whatever he tells you to do. And when you obey, it means you have. When you obey him, it means he has received it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can the Holy Spirit tell me to give my tithe to a brother or a sister? Yes, he can. That's his choice. Do you know the purpose of the tithe? And you must understand this. The principle of tithing started right from the Garden of Eden. When God said, you can eat everything, but this one, leave it for me. I said the principle of tithing, the idea of tithing, started from the Garden of Eden. God knew that a time will come in Deuteronomy chapter 15. God talked about the poor. And God said, you must give to the poor when they show up at your doorpost. In fact, God said, if you have and you don't give to them and they go away empty, they will cry to the Lord. And their cry, God is going to use it to hold it against you. Do you understand that? Do you understand that? And that's what he now said, because the poor you will always have in your midst. You know, Jesus said that also. But God said it first in Deuteronomy 15. Now, because God knew this right from the beginning, he began to make plans right from the beginning on how to take care of the poor. He started his plan. Nothing is new before God. So he set up this whole tithing thing to keep a portion for himself on the earth. As he's blessing men, men will keep a portion for him on the earth. Now, so that God will not come and tell you, give this to this person, and he say, no, this is my portion. He has no legal rights to it. God cannot punish you when you choose not to give him what is yours. Do you understand what I'm saying? You only lose your blessing for obedience. But God cannot say, I'm angry with you, therefore I'll punish you. No, there will be no legal basis for that. It's mine. I can choose to give it. I can choose not to give it. Now, God, knowing that, had to create the tithing principle to say that, look, I want to keep a part for myself of everything that you receive, everything that you are blessed with. Hallelujah. Why? So that I can begin to distribute it to those that I need. And so, at the end of the day, everybody on the earth will be taken care of. Now, that was God's idea. But because we have not followed the principle of God, because we have not truly followed his ways, a lot of people pay tithe, but there's still a whole lot of God's children that are in lack. The reason you find a child of God in lack is simple. Somebody is not paying tithe right. Anytime you see a child of God in need and he's crying, it's a reminder that somebody is disobeying God. Because God had set his plan perfect. There is no mistake with his plan. But men have not obeyed him. Men have chosen to disobey him. And because they have chosen to disobey him, let me read a scripture to you, Galatians chapter 6. Galatians chapter 6. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Verse 7. Look at this. He said, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. Next verse. Now, this is where the problem is. For he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap what? Listen. It says, if you sow to the flesh. What does it mean to sow to the flesh? If you're sowing, or let's use the word tithing. If your tithing is not led by the Spirit of God, you are tithing in the flesh. And when you tithe in the flesh, what are you going to reap? Corruption. You will reap corruption. This is the reason people say, why is it that the church is becoming more worldly? Why is it that you don't find godliness? Why are we not getting deep into godliness and spirituality? Why is it that, you know, think about all the tithe that people have been paying in the flesh. Now, by reason of that, what they are opening up for harvest is what? Corruption. So there's so much corruption. Now, our tithing is supposed to cause the world to be tending towards spirituality. But we find the situation in the opposite direction. You tithe, you still go to the office and somebody says, if you don't give me bribe, you cannot get your contract payment. And you fight, you pray, nothing is going on. And then you say, okay, anyway, it's not bribe, actually, it's just a thank you. Yes, that's what we say now. There's no bribe, it's just appreciation. But we changed it to appreciation because of the pressure they placed on us that we must do it. So you now say, so that it will not be like we're doing something wrong, let's call it appreciation. So now, I cannot bribe you, I can only appreciate you. But he demanded for it. And that's the basis by which he will give you your payment. Corruption. That's where it is from. The corruption you see in the church, the corruption you see in the world, is because of our tithe. Because we are not tithing right. We have been tithing in the flesh. Hallelujah. Look at it. But he who sows, or he who tithes to the Spirit, will of the Spirit reap what? Will reap what? Life everlasting. Life everlasting. How do you tithe in the Spirit? When you go before the Spirit of God and you ask him, Lord, you've blessed me. Here's the tithe of it. Lord, what do you want me to do? Someone says, what if God doesn't speak to me? Or what if I don't hear the voice of God? That's what we've been talking about all weekend. Praise God. This is the voice of God convention. Jesus said, my sheep hears my voice. Every child of God, from the day you got born again, the first thing you're supposed to learn in church is supposed to be how to hear the voice of God. The voice of your pastor is not the voice of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But as a child of God, you must hear the voice of God. If you don't hear the voice of God, then your salvation is not confirmed yet. Hallelujah. Yes, your salvation is not confirmed yet. Now, when we say the voice of God, don't get confused thinking, my soul, how are you? God spoke to me. No, it can be like that. It can be like that. But the most important thing about hearing the voice of God is the knowledge, the knowing that God has spoken to you. The knowing that this is God that just spoke to me. Sometimes it's an impression that comes upon your heart. All of a sudden you just know. Last month I talked about it. I said, how do you differentiate between your mind and the voice of God? It's very simple. Your mind can only say what it knows. Your mind can never tell you what it doesn't know. Praise God. As you're sitting here and you drove to this place, if you hear a voice telling you that your car is outside, is that the voice of God? Talk to me, is that the voice of God? It can't be the voice because you know you left your car outside. But now you can be sitting here and then you're hearing the inner light of your car is on. The inner light of your car is on. And then you go, no, can't be on. No, can't be on. The inner light of your car is on. Let me go check. And then you step out and you see your car and you see the inner light on. Was that your mind? That was what? The voice of God. God just spoke to you. Hallelujah. So the problem with God's children most times is not about hearing his voice. A lot of God's children hear God's voice. In fact, every child of God hears his voice. The problem is they have not learned how to identify his voice. Just like Samuel. Eli did not teach Samuel to hear God. God was already speaking to Samuel before he went to Eli. Am I right? It was the voice he was hearing, Samuel, that was making him run to Eli. The only thing Eli did for Samuel was to teach him how to respond to that voice. Until he was taught, he kept running. Have you ever thought about it? Okay. He's sleeping. And God comes. Samuel. Oh, Eli is calling me. Now, he heard Samuel. Why didn't God say, Samuel, it is not Eli, it is me? He would have heard it too. Am I right? He would have heard it too. But three good times, God, Samuel, and God saw how he would run to Eli. Eli said, no, go and sleep. I didn't call you. He will go back to sleep. Samuel. He will get, why, God, why the second time he should be, It is not Eli. It is I, the Lord. Stay here. Let me talk to you. No, but that's just how God is. Until he gets your attention, he will not speak to you more. Hallelujah. The first thing God always wants to get from you is your attention. Now, when Samuel told him, the next time you hear that voice, this is how to respond. Say, speak, Lord, for your servant is hearing. Now, God came again. You know, when you read that scripture, so funny. The Bible says, and God came again like the former time. Hallelujah. Meaning, now that you have been instructed, let me see. God didn't change his voice. God didn't change his tactics. He still came the same way. Samuel, Samuel. Oh. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. And God began to pour out things to him. It happens to you severally, but you go, my mind is telling me. My mind told me. My mind said that. My mind said this. Or something told me. Something was telling me. And that's how God will be looking at you. It's just like you're in the stage of your Samuel, Samuel. And you can continue like that for years. He won't stop calling you, but he won't tell you more until you recognize him. Philemon tells us that the communication of our faith might be effective by the acknowledging. Acknowledging. We must acknowledge he is the one. Romans tells us that because they did not acknowledge God as God, God gave them over to lasciviousness. You must acknowledge him. When that thing that you think is your mind, when you realize that it's not your mind, what would you do? What did you do? Okay, your mind was telling you that your inner light is on. And then you got up and went to check. And truly, it was on. So what did you hail your mind? Hail my mind. You're very smart too. No. You recognize that this is not my mind. This is God that just spoke to me. Oh, Lord. You just spoke to me. You just spoke to me. I just heard your voice. Thank you. Now, that acknowledgement opens the door. The next time you hear that same thing, say, Lord, is that you? Is that you? You begin to learn. Soon, you become acquainted with the way he speaks to you. He speaks to us differently. And even to one person, he can speak to you in different ways. To one person, he can speak to you with an audible voice. He can speak to you. Sometimes, you're reading the Bible. You know, sometimes, you just are like, I just feel I should read the Bible. I don't know. I'm just feeling I should read the Bible. I'm just open. And then you just say, God just spoke to you. Hallelujah. Now, I'm not talking about you want God to speak to you and say, God, can you please speak to me as I open your word now? Anything I see, let it be your voice to me. And then you now open. No, that won't lead you to, it will lead you astray. He chooses the way he speaks to you. Your own is to recognize his voice. Sometimes somebody is talking to you. You're gisting with somebody and all of a sudden, you just recognize, God just said something to me. The person is talking to you, but you just heard the voice of God. Remember one time Jesus was standing with the people in a crowd. And then Jesus stood and prayed. And when Jesus finished praying, the Bible says God answered. When God answered, people turned and said, the Bible says some people say it thundered. Some others said an angel spoke to him. Meaning they all heard a sound. To some, thunder just said, thunder, is it about to rain? To others that are smarter, that looks like an angel that spoke to him. But what did Jesus say? Jesus said, God just spoke to me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Your problem is not how to hear God. Your problem is how to recognize his voice. But listen, if you must begin your walk of true prosperity, if you must begin to redeem the world from corruption, which is an assignment that every child of God must get involved with, if we must redeem the world from this corruption that has set in, we must begin to tithe and give by the Spirit. Hallelujah. As long as we continue what we are doing, continue to give in the flesh. Oh, have you paid your tithe? Yes. How did you pay your tithe? I paid it in my church. Nah, is that not how you pay tithe? I beg. I don't want all those long stories. You're still giving in the flesh. You are part of the corruption in the church and in the world. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But listen, think about it. When we all begin to give our tithe by the Spirit of God, do you know what's going to happen? Do you not know church is going to lack? Do you also know no brother or sister in the church is going to lack? Because if the church, and secondly, is going to drive all those fake pastors and false prophets out of town, do you know that? It's going to drive them out of town. Because nobody is going to give to them. They can't cajole anybody to give to them. If you are not called, nobody is sending anything to you. Hallelujah. So when you say, why are there false prophets everywhere? You are the cause. You are giving them money. Because somebody comes to your house and tell you 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I say, bring your tithes to me. I say, you carry your tithes to him. No, sir. That's how you contribute to the corruption. So you give them your tithe. You empower them. They deceive more people. But imagine if we all start giving our tithe by the Holy Ghost. And he tells you to send it to so and so. You know, someone read my book on tithing one day. I think I went to fix my tire somewhere. And he saw me. And he walked up to me and said, are you so and so? I said, yes. He said, oh, thank God. I said, what's it? He said, I read your book on tithing. I said, oh, hope it blessed you. He said, that book delivered me. I said, really? He told me, I'm an assistant pastor. And one day, God sent me somewhere to go and pray for certain people. But I didn't have money to go. So that day, early morning, he packed his bag and he started saying, Lord, if truly, truly you have said I should go to that place, then I'm ready. Send the money. And a member of the church knocked and he opened. He said, Pastor, God spoke to me and said I should bring my tithe to you. And he said, no, you're supposed to take the tithe to church. He said, Pastor, God said I should bring it to you. That's why I've come here. And he collected it and prayed for the person, and the person left. Now, his mind was to keep it and then take it to church. But out of curiosity, he just let him open it. And he opened it, and it was exactly the money he was asking God for. He said, well, let me not be doing nonsense here and disobey God. Let me better obey God first. So that's how he went for that judge. He said, since that time, he has been in condemnation, feeling he ate God's tithe. Yes. He said, but when he read my book, and I said, God can send somebody to bring his tithe to you, he said, really? That it delivered him from that condemnation. I thought of how many people were in that boat. But more especially, how many people are in lack and in need because people are there. Say, no, how can I take my tithe to this person? No, I will take it to church. And you take it to church, and church doesn't need it. And now you now put more money in church. The more money now makes the pastor go mad because he has too much money to play around with. I'm telling you the truth. The reason many pastors have gone out of their calling is too much money. You have too much money to play around with. If we live the way God has called us to live, you won't sin much. In fact, you won't have opportunity to sin. I found out, because years ago, God spoke to me and said, you know, when God called me into the ministry and I was asking the Lord, like, how am I going to survive? Because he told me, don't start a church. That's not what I've called you to do. So how am I going to survive? And God specifically told me, said, son, I have money on the earth. And from it, I will give you. I said, hey. Okay. Now that was when God began to give me the understanding concerning tithe. Before I began to even preach it, I began to experience it. Because I started, once he gave me the understanding, that became my practice. That's how I tithe. As a ministry, that's how we tithe. As our lives, my wife and I, that's how we tithe. We actually have a tithe account, a bank account, just for tithe. So as we receive tithe, we put it up there, waiting for the Lord to give us a command. And the moment the Lord gives us a command, we say, thank you, Lord. We rejoice over it. And then we send it out. That is how we live. Most of the things we do, and I'll tell you the truth, it's through tithes that people give to us. And my wife has never opened our mouth to solicit. Come and pay your tithe here now. Never. But it just happens. It just happens. Someone just calls and says, the Lord ministered to me that I sent my tithe to you. We're used to it because that is the truth. Hallelujah. That is how God has set that the world be blessed. When you study the Old Testament, even in the law, God made plans. I just told you one, Deuteronomy 15. He made plans for the poor. He says, whenever a needy person shows up, give him. That's the plan he's making. Do you know God told them, when you harvest your crops, you must make sure you leave some. Don't do too clean. Go and sweep everything and carry. You're wicked. God said, leave some. Why leaving that some? So that those strangers that don't have farmland, that don't have anything to eat, they can come and glean. That's how Ruth got her blessing. Hallelujah. Because God made plans for them. Today, we're in the New Testament. Today, we are led by the Spirit of God. But what's happening? When it comes to the most important thing, to spread the blessing of God in the earth, we go back to the flesh. And because we go back to the... When it comes to prophesying, we stay in the Spirit. So we are prophesying so much, but nothing is happening. Why? Because what is supposed to drive the blessing, we are not receiving it. Because we are not tithing right. You must make up your mind from today. I will not be part of the corruption anymore. It's a decision you must make. We read that scripture. God said, choose life so that you and your descendants may live. Choose life. He says, the one who sows to the Spirit is going to reap what? He's going to reap what? Everlasting life. Everlasting life. That's what will keep you in health. That's what will keep you prosperous. That is what's going to deliver your life from every destruction. When you sow by the Spirit. Hallelujah. Are you willing to make that commitment to God? That from today, with understanding, I'm going to begin to tithe right. It's a decision you must make today. I'm not telling you to bring your tithe to me. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying, go before the Holy Spirit. Before you tithe, let Him direct you. Stay there. Listen, yesterday I talked about how to get God to begin to speak to you. Stay there until He talks to you. There's a lady that sent me a message from Lagos. She's been following my message on Facebook. I've never met her before. So she said, when I taught on tithing before, she said, let her practice it. And she went to open an account. She said, even if it's 200 naira tithe, she will keep it. When she passes by the bank, she will go and pay it into the bank. She said, for months. She was like, God, speak to me. Now, God, speak to me. That she didn't hear God. And she didn't hear God say anything. He said, one day, God just spoke to her and He told her where to take the tithes to. She was so excited. But she said, when she got to the bank and withdrew it, that she saw the money that she has kept, that the money was so big that she has never paid tithe like that before in her life. As in, she felt so, my tithes can do this big thing. I said, yes. That was why he was quiet since. It's not because he didn't want to speak to you, but he wants you to experience this thing. You know, sometimes they tell you, don't keep your tithe, because if you keep your tithe, your things will be tight for you. It's between you and God. No man should interfere with your tithe. It's between you and the high priest himself. He is the one that has it. He is the one that should instruct you concerning it. If he has not instructed you yet, keep it. What if I eat it, then you're not disciplined? Discipline yourself. That's part of the calling. Do you understand what I'm saying? That's part of the calling. You can't be called and you're not disciplined. Discipline yourself. Learn to be disciplined. Hallelujah. Keep it until you will get to that point where his word becomes expressed to you. Now, like I always say, if you want to get somebody to be talking to you often, go and hold their money. Hallelujah. If you have a friend that doesn't call you, maybe you guys speak once a year. Let me give you an assignment. Call him up and say, please, can you give me maybe 50K? Can you just give me 50? There's something I need to do. I'll give you back. And let him give you the 50K. You will notice his calls will increase. Not to ask you for the 50K. He will just go, how now? How are you doing? How is everything? Say, fine, any point. No, I'm just calling to know how you're doing. The call will increase. So if you want to get God to talk to you quickly, hold his money. Hold his money and say, Father, I have your money tight. What do you want me to do with it? Think about it. How many times you have taken tithe, left your house, and you went to bathe in church? Meanwhile, your neighbor was crying to God that he needs money. And God ministered to you. You saw it. And you say, church. That's why I showed you earlier. Even in the Old Testament, there was no place. The only place God told them to take their tithe to church was to go and eat it there. Hallelujah. So you can see that that practice truly has no foundation in the Word of God. It is human doctrine, human teaching, human fabrication. But see how it has held the whole world. That's how far Satan can go to deceive. Not that your pastor is deceiving you. That's what he was taught to. That's what he knows. But now, truth is coming. What are you going to do with the truth? Stand up, everybody. I don't know what you're going to do with this message. But the truth is, you have just heard the message that will transform your life forever if you begin to do it. Let me add one to you. The next time you want to tithe and you go before the Lord, be smart. Put before you bread and wine. You understand that? The communion. Put it before you. You can declare a fast. You can decide, except the Lord interrupts it. You can decide, okay, Lord, I want to be fellowshipping with you concerning my tithe on so and so day of every month. You can decide. I said, except the Lord interrupts it. So don't go and build a religion out of it. But I'm just telling you how you can help yourself. If you choose a day, you can decide on that day I'm going to fast. And that day I'm going to celebrate the blessing of God that God has blessed me. Let's say it's on the 30th of the month or on the 1st of the next month. So that day I'm going to fast. And then I'm going to celebrate the blessing that God has blessed me that month by which I have gotten this tithe. So I'm going to celebrate God that day. I'm going to fast. And in my fast and praise and worship and celebration, I trust that he will speak to me. And when he speaks to you, listen, you are sowing in the spirit. The harvest is not just for yourself. We can change the world from our bedrooms. Do you know that? We can change the world. All these things we do, try to preach to people everywhere, try to preach to people. That's not what Jesus even said. Jesus said, when we love one another, the world will know that God loves us. And when they see it, what do you think will happen to them? Which kind of people are these? Please, I want to join you. That's evangelism. But because we don't do what Jesus has commanded, we're busy gathering people. And so a lot of people are coming into the church, but no change. But when you begin to do this, sow in the spirit, I tell you what you're doing. One, he says you will reap life everlasting. It means previously, if there were people who are troubling you, by your sowing in the spirit or tithing in the spirit, God will begin to nip them. God will begin to nip them. Do you know you can show up and a fear will come on somebody that normally takes bribe from people? When you show up, a fear just comes on him and say, it's you now. Do it. That's why I say we can change the world from our bedroom. So what would you do with this? Accept it first of all. Believe it. Begin to practice it. Then next, teach it. Tell someone about it. Share this truth. If the world must change, this is how it will change. If we continue to sow in the flesh, we will continue to expand the corruption until the corruption will envelop us. Can you begin to pray?